Right now we're going to do the electronics review for my new Stabycraft 2750 centre cab. At the heart of it all is my Fruno gear that I've known and trusted for 20 years now. Well, beyond that, 20 years recreationally, before that commercial fishing. And it's come such a long way, and it's finished up here with this TZ Touch 3. And just like all the TZ Touches that have gone before it, it integrates all of the equipment on the boat. So I've got my digital radar on the roof, I've got my Chirp 2kW transducer beaming down through the hull, and also the WASP transducer. It pulls everything all in together, and I can monitor everything all in the one place. And as the name suggested, TZ Touch, it's a touch screen. And what's so wonderful about the Fruno gear is just intuitive. If you want to know how to do something or what to do, even if you've never used it before, just touch it. I'll touch that mark there. It's asking me if I want to go to it, move it, rename it, edit it, or delete it. Simple. I could touch anywhere, saying, do you want to put a new point here? Create a new boundary. You can even plot courses that hook directly into your autopilot that it follows. Everything is like child's play. If you can work an iPad or an iPhone, you can work TZ Touch. I'm just going to take you through a few of the features that I use regularly. So I've got a home screen set up with all the popular pages that I use. I could watch TV on here if I wanted to, satellite TV. This is a favorite page of mine where I can watch TV, I can watch the sounding, and I also got my plotter. Interestingly there, you'll see when I look at the plotter, there's AIS targets all over the place. These little triangles are boats that are all around here in the bay, and because I've got a Fruno VHF, that VHF antenna picks up the transponders on all of those boats, so I can see all of the boats that are around me on my screen, and even get details on the vessels, their speed, their course, and everything. And so let's take a look at how this AIS works. So the vessel over there, that's obviously the Silvertip, and I know that because it's popped up on my AIS. The Silvertip's now on the move, so we can see that it's doing 9.6 knots. And what it also does is it gives us an intercept line and gives us a warning. So automatically, this Fruno gear calculates an intercept point and a potential collision. Now, we can go a step further with that, and we can overlay radar. Okay, so of course now the radar, we can see it clearly picking up the Silvertip, but it's also picking up a bunch of fishing boats here around Onslow Rock. It's picking up the mainland, and where the overlay is really good is that the radar is showing you exactly what's there right now. So GPS isn't always accurate because satellites can fall out of range. The radar, when it's running overlay, if it's following the contours of the land, you at least know that your GPS is accurate at that point in time. If I range out, I can see that there's another vessel there. Now if I touch acquire, that's locked onto that boat instantly like that. Now I can see that that boat is doing 24.2 knots and it's 0.63 of a mile away from me. You see over here, I've locked onto another target, and that's giving me, saying it's only doing 2.5 knots. That boat there is likely drift fishing. This one here is obviously trucking along at 24 knots. Acquire, and now I'm locked onto that boat on my radar. And so long as that radar stays on and they stay within the range, which is on a day like today, about 20 miles, I know what every boat is doing around me. Now the radars typically have been the domain of safe navigation, particularly at night time. It's giving you a scan of everything that's around you. But we can see that during the day I've been able to identify boats, but they can be used as a fishing tool also. I simply go into the menu, I swipe up. You'll see right at the top of the menu here, I've got bird mode. And also I've got to decide on whether it's calm, moderate or rough. I'm going to go for moderate. Now that's set the sensitivity, so I'm not going to get too much wave clutter. Now out here you can see these obvious big targets. They're all the boats out in front of me. Now I can't see any birds with my naked eye. In fact, I can see one out there. And what I'm looking for is a mark with a little blue edge around it and a smudge and a trail behind it. This smudgy little cluster down there could be a cluster of birds. Oh yes, there they are. There they are. How good is that? Look at that. That there is a cluster of birds. This here, the solid target, that's the yacht out there, but in between it, there's a single gannet, and you can just see as it's tracking along there, it's leaving an echo trail. Now that is a single bird, and it's only flying a meter off the water, and I can mark it on my radar. Now, of course, how that helps us is that birds are with bait fish, and then bait fish are usually with predatory fish. And we've actually got an example that you can watch on ultimatefishing.tv of how we have marked birds with the radar that the naked eye had no chance of seeing. We went over, we picked up the bait fish on the side scan, we turned around with the boat, marked the bait fish on the sounder, and we raised the marlin. It got away, but that's not the point. We found one, which all started from a bird radar. The simplicity of this, if I'm being honest, it's the first time I've even turned it on, and I was trying to explain it, and that was so simple to use and worked incredibly well. But really, the guts and the pedigree with Furuno is in the sounding. If we take a look at the soundings, we're just drifting along here in 30 meters of water. You can see I'm getting great definition on the bottom. I'm picking up even the weed. With Furuno models, you can have bottom discrimination, unique things like AccuFish, which measure the size of the fish and display them on your chart. No other brand of electronics has got that. There's a clever little algorithm that they drop in there that will measure the size of your fish. The most common screen setting that I run with is just a split screen. Plot of this side, and I've got sounder on this side. And the beauty of it all, say I've marked a blob of bait there, it's just about to go off the screen. I can actually stop that and I can wind it back. In fact, I can go back and look at the history of anything that I've been over. Now, if I see these targets here, that looks like multiple fish. In reality, that's a fish that's been swimming in and out of the beam, I believe. Nonetheless, it's still a decent fish, so I'm gonna touch it. I'm gonna put a new point. Because it's yet unidentified, I just like to put a little flag. That flag is at that point. Now, I can double back and go and take a closer look at that. Now, if I'm certain it's a fish, I can either drop a lure down, or I can just touch the mark either on here, or I can touch it on the screen, and I can edit it, and I can say, that's a fish, or it's a good fishing spot. And you can just customize all the symbols, and as you can see, I'm literally flying by the seat of my pants here because I know this stuff inside out, but just the way that I'm touching through things, it's very simple. The sounding technology is allowing even marks as close as just a meter or so off the bottom. It's not amalgamating them with the bottom. It's differentiating the bottom structure, and it's giving me a clear gap. So there's fish down there that we're marking right now. So if you want to know more, we've got a lot more detailed stuff. How we use a combination of radar, side scanning, and then deep sounding to find game fish, deep water fish, everything from snapper to swordfish, you will find how to tune your gear in at ultimatefishing.tv. So that's really just a quick overview. And right here is this thing. It is the screen for my Wasp. The brains of it are all installed underneath the bunk. The huge transducer is right down there on the keel line that we've developed a special pod for to get a crystal clear image. And this is the screen that displays all of that data. It's New Zealand technology that's been developed, and it's taken the world by storm. Largely because everywhere I go in this boat, I've got a 120 degree beam, a swathe, that the deeper the water gets, the wider the beam gets. And when I'm hitting the sea floor, I'm getting a real-time picture drawn onto my map over the top of existing charts. So I'm getting every detail. So now here's a rock that I've recently just driven over in the boat. You can see here we are way away here in the boat, but this is what I've just driven around, and this is quite dramatic. We see that there's this big gut running right up the middle, this extreme drop off here, which you would think would hold fish. Now, we can't see fish on there at the moment, and that's because in my display history, I've got the fish marks turned off. So I just jump into the chart and I take a look at water column targets, and I'm only looking at targets from the last 5 minutes at the moment. So if I extend that to all, now there they go. These are all the fish marks. Well, they're not all the fish marks, because you see back down here, I'm filtering out. I've got color erase set to minus 26. So anything with a signal strength weaker than that has been filtered out. These are only the big predatory fish, things like snapper, kahawai, and even kingfish. But once we get off the edge of that hill, look at that, and in there I'm sure will be some kingfish. Just my first little scoot around this rock, you can see some of the potential from having this incredible tool on the boat. And so I can actually 3D model just like this out to 450 meters deep. So all of those deep canyons where I've previously only got a temporary 2D view, I'm now getting a permanent 3D view. So I can model all of the canyons, the seamounts where I'm getting puka, bass, bluenose, those deep trenches where I'm getting swordfish. I can 3D model down to 450 meters. And when I'm not 3D modeling, I can just use it as a high definition sounder because it's 160 kilohertz, which is still a high frequency, but it's got the power to penetrate. So already I've been getting crystal clear images as deep as 650 meters. And that was on my first outing to test this out, and I caught a swordfish. So already it's been successful and I'm just learning it. So stay tuned because there's going to be more developments coming with WASP that I'm going to be able to show you. And I've literally just got my hands on it. I'm already blown away. And once I've really got it locked and loaded, this gear, not only can I show you guys, but those fish are in trouble. I've got my autopilot here, which is super simple to use. Push the button, it locks me on my course. I can make course adjustments nice and easily by pushing the buttons. And I've got that Sabiki mode, which means basically it can work in reverse and I can use it like a spotlight in conjunction with my two Evinrude E-Tech engines. That is a real asset of having the Furuno autopilot. And furthermore, it comes with a remote, which allows me to steer from anywhere in the boat. Why don't I just give that a go and see if this works as well? I've never actually tried it. I'm just getting us up to speed. Now, normally I would just hit auto there, and there you go. I'm on autopilot right now, one push of the button. But I'll turn my remote on, and here we go. It says that I'm on auto, that our course is 178 degrees. I hit standby. There you go, we're on standby. So now I'm on steering mode. Now, one of the things that's really cool about this remote is that you can actually steer by pointing this remote. So I can hold the button down, I can point over there, and look at that, the boat goes over there. When I let go, it holds my course. That's honestly the first time I've tried that. And there you go, when I talk about the simplicity of Furuno gear, they've come out with a completely new function that I've never tried. I did watch a YouTube video for about 30 seconds on my way out this morning. Look at that. Okay, let's go over there towards that yacht. Hold the button down, point over there. And here we go. We're going over there. Release the button. And we stay on the course as soon as I take my thumb off of it. So that just allows me to have this in my pocket, move anywhere around the boat, potentially when I'm trolling or running in home, and leave the helm but drive with this remote. Nice work, Furuno. Go. So let's come outside and give this thing a go. I'm just gonna select, this is my station. Put the boat into reverse. Sabiki mode comes up. There you go, select it. Now I'm in Sabiki mode. So because I've set it, those outboard motors are holding the boat on exactly the same orientation that I left it, and just by using the throttle, I can choose to actually hold on the spot, go up against the wind or the current, or drop the revs off and actually have a slow drift down current. And I can make adjustments as I go just by using little increments. Hitting the buttons there now, and I'm turning those motors left and right. So it just saves the need to have a steering wheel out here when I can do it all in one hand with the push of a button on my thumb. Also on here, the Furuno VHF. Again, all Furuno, they all talk to each other. This here is basically the signal receiver for the AIS and just gives me great clear calling. So no crackle going through the radio, it's just a good quality set. And a good advantage that I can change channel here on the remote, switch between high and low, or in an emergency, I can cut straight to channel 16. I've got my zip wake trim tabs. They just stay on auto. They look after themselves. Now I've got the option to control my Fusion Stereo from an app on my phone. I can go through all of my music and everything right here on my phone that's on display and permanently on charge. Or if we go to the head unit itself, it's the first unit in the world to have an integrated touchscreen system. And it's really intuitive to just flick through tracks, artists, genres, everything. Great, again, if you can operate a smartphone, you can operate one of these, but of course the real guts is in the sound. And I've got a 7-speaker setup here. I've got 2 speakers up the front, I've got 2 in the deck roof, I've got another 2 back in the bait station, and the 7th speaker is the subwoofer. I've got an amplifier which I run on a separate switch, because when you're really cranking it, you're really drawing some current. A lot of the time you might just where you want to cruise along, just listen to some nice ambient music, turn the amplifier off. With a flick of a switch, this bad boy lights up.